Welcome back. I just tried a little musette here on my little friend. Let me put this down. I'll be right back with you. Welcome back to part two of Cannes and the French Riviera. Glad you came back. Oh, I just dropped my big concert accordion there, played a little musette. It's fun music to play, to be honest. A little tricky in the bass, but it's kind of cool. So part two, thank you for coming back and joining me. We're going to talk about Monaco a lot. But before we do that, we're going to show you what we did in Saint-Tropez on the beach to make some money for our depleted wallets. Here we go.
Cost of living in Europe, it's quite a bit expensive actually. Right here in the French Riviera, it's extremely expensive. The euro is pretty high. All the places are very expensive. So Alex figured out actually a way to finance the trip. I mean, not only on the fact that we eat, we drink, we go out, but he has a very, very, very specific concept that he's selling right now walking on the beach. You know those little vendors? Alex become one of them. Look at it.
Six massage. Oh, hello.
Six massage. Hey, Faz, let's go. Go, these people that want it. Guess they found someone. Sex massage. The best team in LA. Please, sex massage, everybody. Yeah. You want it? It's 2 for 1.
Sex massage. Well, yeah. Granted, it's a goofy concept and it was not really as successful as we were hoping it to be. From then on out, we decided we gotta come up with something different. So we went back to the car and drove the long road through all the crazy tunnels in the mountains towards Monaco, which at this point is roughly an hour away with beautiful scenery and a lot of tunnels. And while we're watching at these images, I'm gonna tell you a little bit about Monaco and its history. Yeah, like everything in Europe, Monaco was also very, very old. I mean, it goes back to the earliest human being settler ships on the coast here. Then in the 6th century, it was under Greece colonization. The Romans took it over in 830 after Christ. In 1215, the Italians under Fulco di Castello began to build the fortress that you now see today, the old walls that you still did for the inner city, if you like. And in the Grimaldi family, then in 1297 to 1338, took it over. And what they did, they actually started what we know the modern Monaco. I mean, they actually invaded the English fleet and in a naval campaign in Southampton, in the Channel. They took all the riches from there, brought it back to Monaco, and started their little empire, if you like. The classic casino and the Hotel de Paris opened in 1883. Then in 1942, the Italians took it over under Mussolini. Then Mussolini gave it in 1943 to the Germans, till it finally got liberated in September of 1944 and became under the French protectorate, and is what we know the Principale of Monaco today, with all its traditions. After the beautiful, beautiful ride on along the French coast, on the French Riviera, through the mountains, through all these tunnels and these beautiful roads, it was really good, good scenery and good fun. We dropped our bags. You know, I was staying in the Rocabella in Monaco, in the center of Monaco, which I'll show you in a minute. And Faz was staying at a friend, I think, at that time. We had two hitchhikers, literally. Well, they got stranded in Cannes, two ladies that we from America that we took with us to Monaco, and they were chatting it up in the car, blah blah blah, blah. But thank God they fell asleep after a while, so that was good. And so we got there, and the first thing we wanted to do is we wanted to look at the old village, the one that I explained earlier. Well, sort of a pirate's town, if you like. And so we cruised around a bit there, and I'll show you what happened up there at the old village castle walls.
So today we got actually hitchhiked away by two American women.
I'm having such a fun time here on Le Roc.
I think these are all pictures.
This is what we do. We pick up two girls. Hi. They're American girls.
Je m'appelle Linda.
They are tourists. They saw the Cooper. Oui. They saw the pass, you know, about Cannes. And just, I say, okay, jump in. We're going to Monaco.
So, but anyway, we're here now.
Yeah. Oh, you see, there's a big cannon behind
yes,
us.
Yeah. Because it turns out that in the old days, Monaco, the principality of Monaco was actually a pirate's little mountain in the sea where they robbed the ships. They would go to Marseille before they became legal.
Really? What is legal?
Having a lot of money and don't pay any taxes. This is what Monaco is all about, people. This is a tax haven, except you have an American passport. You are... Yes.
Okay, so pirates like Pirates of the Caribbean? Okay, good. But we'll keep you updated and stay tuned because this is Monaco's segment.
Segment one, and we come back and we show a little bit of the racetrack and what's going on around here before the madness starts, which is on Wednesday.
Now here are a few pictures from the old village, the Pirates Village, if you like. This is the old harbor down there. Generally, I know you hear me saying this a lot, but Monaco is like a huge, huge anthill. There's a lot of small little roads and stairways and secret passages and all sorts of stuff, which means you need to be physically really fit because you will do a lot of walking. The population of Monaco currently is roughly around 40,000. And 16,000 of them, a third, are multi-millionaires, which makes this place into the one city on the planet with the most millionaires per capita. And it's also very, very dense. I mean, you have like 20,000 people per square kilometer. And besides of the fact that it's absolutely beautiful here, if you decide to live in Monaco, you better bring a minimum of 500,000 euro for the first year for an application for them to consider you.
Oh, Alex, what are you having on your head?
I could not withstand to buy an MC hat, Monaco. I know, but this is the last, that was the last cheesy one.
Actually, this is the last cheesy one. There was worse.
That was worse.
Yeah.
Yes.
So we're right here, still in Monaco, and you know next week we'll be in the Grand Prix, and Alex actually decided to show us and explain to us a little bit more about what is the Grand Prix of Monaco is about. So, Alex, what is the Grand Prix of Monaco?
The Grand Prix of Monaco is actually the mother race of Formula One. It's pretty much where it all started. And, you know, literally people actually say it was Ferrari's test track. Okay? I know, but it's not true anymore. When when we look at the racetrack, it goes straight through the city. That actually built around it, which makes it absolutely nuts. We're talking about a car that weighs less than 750 pounds, has 850 horsepower, has 19,000 revolutions in the engine on an 8-cylinder engine, and does up to 320 miles an hour. And that in corners, it would actually make everybody fly out with a smaller car.
So it's not the Yugo?
It's not necessarily, no. Okay. It's really fun. So, and if you look down here, that's why this part is kind of interesting. If you look down here, you see the sign that says V-Power. This is the boxes. This is where the engine has to have to come in order to get serviced.
We did the whole tour around, and if I'm not wrong, Alex was behind the pit stop.
So now we're entering the holy grail of the race, which is the pit stop area. Right now it's closed off, but we're going very close now.
Hey Alex!
Hey, what's going on?
Good, I was explaining actually that you were walking from the back of the pit stop. It was a fun, the other
where
tour.
We just been.
Yep.
From the top of the rock, and if you look down the road, it's exactly where I come through. The pit stop is going to be now on your left side. So come through here and shoot through this tunnel. And then they're going to make a big left bank into the tunnel and come out of the harbor that we showed you earlier in the show. So this is just a fraction of the track, but you kind of get an idea how tiny and how insanely tight this race is.
Yeah, and I think if I remember, they have to go up to that hill.
That's
and
right.
It's pretty loud.
It's super loud.
And if you see here, this is the yacht. all the yacht are here. It's not the best spot. Last year I was here, loud. You hear just the car racing and pissing. But at the end of the day, you know what? You're here in Monaco. You live it. You breathe it. You smell the rubber.
I love it. Yeah. That's why we're here. Yeah. That's the whole point.
Oh, the tire wall.
The tire wall. Yeah. Let's see what the tires are wall. But
these tire walls are actually worn out 207 and 306 Formula One tires.
That just, you know, usually would get demolished, and now they're here as a wall, as protection if you run into them. And trust me, with these kind of speeds coming out of this corner, if you look how tight this corner is. Might need them.
But also, I will say, if you go inside, you don't see it well, but everything's got fences. They fence everything, so if you don't have a pass, you cannot get in. And also, if there's anything flying in the air,
it will catch it. And that's why, if you don't have a pass in Monaco during the 4 days, you cannot go anywhere.
You're just screwed.
It's not a joke. You cannot go anywhere. Exactly. Not just for cars. It's like, we show you, these barriers, they're not put up yet, you know? But they will be all over town.
Yeah, and they have big doors, big metal doors, and I'm telling you, if you don't have the right accreditation, the right pass, you're not in the game.
But guess what?
VIP.
You got a little impression of the racetrack there and how really crazy it is. And again, you have to think about it. This is a small, really tight village the way it is already. And through that village, you saw it in the map, it goes through town, through the harbor, back up under the hill that I was standing on to show you. Camp coming back, running through the harbor again, through the village. The noise in there is absolutely insane. It's insane. It's like prehistoric wasps just invaded, you know, the planet. It's crazy. The ground is literally shaking when these cars coming by or shift, especially in that corner when they came out of the tunnel. Yeah, that was so, we had the chance to took our car and drive through that racetrack in a regular speed, obviously, but you know, let's just get a feel for it, what they have to deal with. And this is really is quite remarkable. Quite remarkable. Now, at this point I want to show you where I lived a little bit. I lived in an apartment building called Da Roccabella. And the Roccabella is pretty much in the center of that, I call it the anthill. Because Monaco is like an anthill. It's a small amount of real estate, tons of people, and everything is tunneled and under-tunneled, and there's stairs here, and there's a little way going there, and a secret passage going somewhere else. And it's really tricky to get around, especially during the race, because like we just said, they block everything off. Everything is blocked off. Unless you have a pass, you cannot go anywhere. And your pass has to be specific. It is literally an address. You cannot go anywhere else but to that address. And we get there in a second. First of all, I'm gonna show you where I lived, in the Roccabella, in the middle of Monaco.
I'm now in Monaco, in a place called the Roccabella, which is one of the most central apartment buildings here. And I just wanna give you a quick view what it looks like to live really crappy. You can see, if you look at the city, it's like a big anthill, and it's all tunneled, and that is secret elevators that go to different levels and roads, and an absolute marvel of architecture, and rather dense. This is probably the most amount of millionaires on the smallest amount of square footage on the planet. A lot of tall buildings here. So let's walk to the other side. This is the mountains behind me, and now we go towards the ocean. Go through the hallway. Shiny and clean. And here we come, this is the fun part. This is what I see when I wake up in the morning. Absolutely horrifying. Ugly. There's not one boat out there that you see that is less than $20 million. I'm gonna zoom in on a few of them. I just wanna give you a broad pan.
over there in the distance where you see that little nose sticking out, this is the old rock. This was the old village. Right before that is where the race cars will pass through in 2 days' time and create one of the biggest spectacles on the planet, the Formula One Grand Prix of Monaco. So, down here is the pool. Oops.
That was a little inside in a very, very expensive apartment building that is pretty much in the center of Monaco. The reason why they're so expensive, these places, A, there's not a lot of space for people to build. So as you could tell, everything is like stacked up high and skyscrapers and stuff like this. And the second reason is Monaco, like I mentioned before, is a tax haven. So a lot of Germans, French, British people, Russians, you know, go to Monaco to avoid paying taxes. It's a tax-free zone. The downside is in order to live in Monaco, you need to bring a lot of money. So that's why it's not a lot of people who can afford to live in Monaco. On the other hand, it's a very safe place. I mean, there's rumors that you can literally park your open Cabrio Rolls Royce with a wallet in it and they would probably call the police. Nobody would steal it. Number one, nobody needs to. And number two, you don't get out of this town. They can shut it down in within 10 minutes. There's no way to get out of it. So they'll find you. Now, I'm gonna show you a little bit what it took to actually get to the racetrack. I had two access passes. One to the balcony, a shot that you maybe saw earlier from me shooting down at these cars coming out of this tunnel around the corner. And the second one was to the paddock area, where I also had a friend who was, emergency services. You know, he was a doctor. So in case something happens to one of the drivers. So I had a pass to the paddock area, to the pit crew. I showed you a little bit of that earlier. But now I want to show you how and what it took to actually get down there.
So here's one of the gates we talked about it earlier. As you can see, it's all blocked off. Nobody can get through. The only passage is these small pathways on the side. Until you get to your block, see, you have your block number here. Right? And it will say which block you are, and this is your access point. It's the only way to get in. There's no other way. Alright, I'll try to get there. It's a little walk, but keep you posted. So, I found my entry point here at Rue Coast, and I'm gonna walk to the stands now. It took me an hour. But you can see a little glimpse of the racetrack right down here. Check in with you a little bit later. So I made it down to the racetrack, so now finally here's the racetrack. I'm right down at it. Not quite sure I'm at the right spot yet. I'm going to still keep looking after many stairs and elevators and tunnels and stuff, but I'm in the big curve where actually the finish line is. I'm looking at straight at it. And we're going to hang out for a second and see if they come by here and then find our spot.
Yeah, as you could see, this was quite a headache to actually get to my spot and then back through all these gates again to the other spot. But I had time. There's 3 days of racing, okay? Actually, four. It starts on Wednesday. Wednesday is the veteran race, which means you have vintage race cars there from the 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, you know, that drive sometimes, races, time trials, all sorts of different things. It's really interesting to watch. It's kind of fascinating to see the car manufacturing history unfold in front of you on a racetrack. It's kind of cool. On Thursday, there is like then the race of the old veterans, like ex-Formula One drivers show up and celebrities, and the mayor and the prince of Monaco was allowed to drive through the racetrack, and there's meet and greets and stuff like this. Friday is practicing. That's where they drive the best to get their cars in shape for the race and the qualifying on Saturday. which means this is where they tweak stuff, they run races, they see what the time is, they adjust things, minute things sometimes, because we're talking about hundreds and thousands of seconds here that make a difference in a race like this. And especially in a tiny spot like this, unlike, let's say, the Texas Grand Prix or Bahrain or Francorchamps in Belgium or Silverstone, England, where you have time and room to actually overtake someone. In Monaco, if you're not one of the four first, maybe five first cars, it's gonna be really, really hard to come from the back through these tiny roads and surpass other cars to make it to the front. So that was that part. On Saturday then was the qualifying. Didn't do much filming there because it's just boring. It's basically just stopping time and see, you know, who is on the pole position.
Okay, Saturday, qualifying day. And this is what it looks like around 1400. Going towards the pit lanes. Here we meet Faz. Grand Prix Saturday, Monaco, right here, right now. It's Faz Brahimi. It has nothing to do with the Grand Prix anymore, whatever I'm just reading.
But it's all crazy.
It's all crazy. It's already have all the vendors. It's all about merchandising. They want to make money. They want you to remember that day. Alex is behind the camera, and we'll see him in front of the camera because we do other segment. We're taking you to the paddock. Pit, amazing. Never seen anybody can do. Man, it's us. You know us. Hey, let's go.
And after that day, we decided to take a little trip around Monaco and find some place to eat. And we got a little tip there. We went a little bit outside, not necessarily a suburb, it's still Monaco, but it's called Cap Ferrat. And in Cap Ferrat, which is like really up the hill, overlooking a beautiful bay, like a windshielded bay where the old sailboats used to sit and park, if you like, to get out of the storms where the Mistral winds came through the French coast, so they wouldn't be damaged. So you're overlooking this place in Cap Ferrat. I always called it the Hurricane Bay. Of course, there's no hurricanes in Europe, but in Cap Ferrat there's a restaurant called the Chèvre d'Or, Le Chèvre d'Or, the Golden Sheep. And we were invited to talk to someone. We could not afford to eat there because it's outrageous. I mean, you probably pay 1,500 to 2,000 euros for a regular meal for two people. It's for us, it's totally ridiculous. But we had a cup of coffee, it was only 50 bucks. And we talked to Karin and the maître de cuisine there and show you a little bit of this place, Le Chèvre d'Or in Cap Ferrat.
This fabulous place, and we hooked up with Karin, who knows all about this place. So what is this? Where are we? What does this place have? What does it do? Who comes here?
Oh, a lot of people, a lot of American people. We have here a very beautiful view, which you should see later on at the bar. And many, many rooms all around the village.
So it's a hotel?
It's a hotel,
you can actually
yes.
come here and book a room. It's very romantic.
Yes, very romantic. People like that. Many honeymooners.
Aha. Uh-huh. Yeah. And I heard you have one of the most famous restaurants in
yes.
the coast.
Indeed.
Yes, you do.
Just upstairs, Chateau de la Chèvre d'Or.
Chateau de la Chèvre d'Or.
Yeah, with two Michelin stars. Mm-hmm. Very famous.
Two stars?
Yes.
Yes.
Which is very famous.
Michelin?
Michelin, yes.
Wow.
So, and Karin, this is interesting because Karin is actually not French. She is from Munich, Germany. And she lives here since when?
4 years.
4 years.
4 years, yes. Enjoying the sun and the beautiful view. So, very nice here.
So, in other words, if you want to meet really beautiful women and eat fantastic, you gotta come here.
Hello everybody, we're still at the Chèvre d'Or, so we met with Alex, we met the front people. Now, what is the good things about here, this place, it's not only the food, two stars Michelin of the restaurant, the great hotels, but I don't know if you see in the back of me, it's the view, Cap Ferrat. For those who knows, it is actually one of the amazing place, and I am going to see our dear friend, Alex. Alex, how are you, man?
Oh, here we are. We just talked to Karin up in the reception area with Philip and Karin, the Munich girl. This is the most fabulous view you're going to have in the whole French Riviera. I'm not overstating this. It's not really cheap either, isn't it?
No, I mean, you know what? Good things, beautiful things cost
a lot of money. Yeah. So here's Philip.
Oh,
here's Philip.
C'est Philippe.
Philippe.
Oh, Philippe is always working. He's running around.
He's busy.
But I don't know if you see on the back, right behind, yes. actually, Alex, it's the view.
It's amazing.
This is the one of the best views.
And Roland told me a secret earlier, because Roland builds one of the most amazing yachts in the world. Marco Polo series. And he said, when the wind, the Mistral, is too strong in Monaco in the bay, all the boats come here.
So those are the all little lights that you see right here in the bay. They were actually this morning and late night in Monaco. Now they're back here. It's safe. There's no wind, actually less wind.
And this was the little visit up in the hill in a little bit outside of Monaco. Still within the confines of Monaco, but, you know, a little suburb, if you like, on in Cap Ferrat, the Chèvre d'Or, fantastic restaurant. They were super nice, treated us nicely. We had a pastis and a cup of coffee. That was already like $50 or something crazy. And then came Saturday. Saturday was really busy, a lot of tourists and a lot of stuff. I show you a little bit of that scene right here in that picture. And then we move on to the Sunday racetrack. But before we go to the Sunday racetrack, we came back to Cap Ferrat and took a little trip through the old pirate village, which is now converted into a hotel. So all these little houses that used to be in that pirate village in these big, big masonry walls and our little hotel rooms, and you can book them and stay there. Absolutely fantastic. And I also introduce Roland to you, who builds one of the best boats in the world, the Marco Polo series. Big, big boats, 46, 56, 66 meters, like massive. Let's do that right now.
Oh, here's Roland.
Ah, Bruno. Hey. He's the owner of the Marco Polo.
At the fantastic Matsu, which is a 50 meter, 40, 45, 50 meter, fantastic super yacht.
Wow.
Yes. And Roland just...
How big is the yacht?
Roland knows
46
exactly.
meters.
46 meters.
So it is the top of the game and the creme de la creme.
Yes. Absolutely.
I heard something about the engine. It's the most low efficient engine.
It's the most environmental friendly engine on the planet.
You see, eco-friendly people, somebody's taking care of you.
That's
and
right.
It's not only beautiful, but it's very good also.
It's very good. And Roland explained to us how fabulous this place is, because he was the one who suggested this was actually an old village where the people protected them from the pirates. And the hotel and the restaurant we just looked here and we just showed you guys is a conglomeration of all these little houses made into one. And we were just walking through one of the little passageways right now.
So we're going to walk. I'm going to follow you guys.
Yes.
Roland, show us what it is. It's crazy, crazy place, I'm telling you. It's spooky, I think there is ghost.
This is the other entrance where you usually would come up.
That's
in the
other entrance. And if you see in the back, there is ghost. So it's like a small town feeling, you know?
Yeah, but all the houses are now reorganized. There are kitchens in it and stuff. And you know,
see, this is actually kind of spooky.
On Sunday, it was horrendously loud and I was surrounded by other people. I didn't do much filming either, but I'm going to show you some.
Right here, one of the chicanes going to the block, and it's so loud. The floor is actually shaking. It's absolutely insane. I love that.
While we watch this crazy, insane noise in the tiny village of Monaco, maybe a little facts about the Formula One race itself. The original race, the first, very, very first race in Monaco was in 1929, and it was won by a guy called Grover Williams in a Bugatti. The most wins ever in Monaco were by a Brazilian driver called Ayrton Senna. The course itself that you saw on the map earlier was 78 laps, and to combine the 78 laps make roughly 2,074 miles in total that these cars have to drive in one piece. You cannot change a car, so it's one car. It is deemed as the most important car race in the world, next to the race of the 24 Hours of Le Mans and the Indianapolis 500.
Yeah.
Did you see that?
There's 19 Formula One teams, which each own roughly four cars and team members and this and this and what have you, staff. Roughly one team a year costs you $380 to $400 million. And the engine alone in one of those cars, when it's built, is $7 million. And this engine can produce up to 20,000 RPMs. During the 78 grueling rounds with G-forces up to 4G, there's going to be 3,600 gear changes, on average is 47 a lap. Even though a Formula One car reaches easily 280 to 320 miles an hour, in the narrow streets of Monaco, they're still running through the hairpin curve right in front of the tunnel with 147 miles an hour. The car itself accelerates from 0 to 60 in 1.6 seconds with an engine with 980 horsepower. It weighs only 1,100 pounds and at 60 miles an hour, it only needs 40 feet to brake to a complete stop. This shot right here, you see Fozzie with like sign language. It was so intense that the glasses on the balcony would shake the liquid out of it. These drivers need to drink a lot of water and liquids because they usually lose up to 4 kilos or almost 1.5 gallons in weight, mostly in water, during one of these races. So an average of 8 liters before they start racing is not unheard of. They are some of the most highly conditioned athletes in the world. They undergo a grueling daily fitness routine. In some of the corners of Formula One racing, your head alone can weigh 5 times its normal weight. The Ferrari team from Italy in Marinello won 15 years that title in Monaco. Yeah, and now we're coming to the end of my little trip to Cannes with Faz Brahimi, and it was a great time there. I hope you enjoyed it a little bit, and I hope you come back for future episodes of Bubenheim Goes West here on YouTube. Be kind to each other. I hope you have a wonderful time, and I see you soon. And while I leave you with a few of my favorite shots from the harbor and the beautiful boats there, a little list of people who live there, just a small example. First of all, of course, there's Prince Albert II and his wife Stephanie, the princess and the prince of Monaco. Race car drivers live there. Jenson Button, Nico Rosberg, David Coulthard. But other sports and celebrities like Roger Moore, Rafael Nadal and James Caan. And what are they doing all day? Well, they live really well and they go to some really good and expensive restaurants. Some of the most expensive restaurants in Monaco is obviously the Café de Paris, the Elsa, the Hostellerie Jérôme and Le Louis XV. And at night, when it comes time to like have a drink and go out dancing, we meet at Jimmy's. Jimmy's is the place to be. Then there's the Le Bar des Américains, Le Notre Bleu, and the casino. I hope you have a good time, and I see you next time on Bubenheim Goes West. Goodbye from Monaco for now.
Princess right here. Monaco right here, right now.